morning and welcome to Sunrise Community Church. My name is Greg. I'm the Youth and Children's Director here at Sunrise. And we're just so grateful for you choosing to worship with us on our online service. We're so much looking forward to the one day when we get to be together as God's people in the same building, in the same area. But for right now, we also are just enjoying the fact that we are still spiritually together under the authority of Christ and looking towards His kingdom and seeing that He's speaking to each one of us right where we're at. And that it's kind of in a way nice that distance, no matter where you're at here in the world, you can be plugged into your community here at Sunrise. And so a couple of things we want to make you aware of that are coming up is first thing is our Oasis summer meetings that we do on Wednesday nights. We're going to continue to be able to do that through the summer. We're starting that up on June 24th, and we're going to be starting that at 6:30. And the things that are going to be a little bit different this year, just so that we can make sure everyone's staying safe, is that we won't be having any dinner for that event, but we're still hoping that we can still get together and share just in the blessing of hearing God's word and letting that resonate in our hearts, but also being able to share with each other from a little bit more distance than normal, but still share with what God's doing in each of our lives and feel that connection. So again, that's Wednesday nights at 6:30 here at Sunrise Community Church on our campus, and that's starting on June 24th. The other thing that's coming up right after that is our graduation Sunday. Graduates, we want to celebrate with you. We know that in a lot of ways that's looked so different for you this year, and we don't want to miss it. And so we're doing a little bit later so that we can make sure we can get everyone, and everyone's got that all coordinated. So June 28th, that'll be on our online service here and also at our live service, our outdoor service as well. And we just want to celebrate you. We big thing about being God's family is that we do all kinds of things together. We pray for each other, we laugh with each other, we cry with each other, and we celebrate with each other. And so we want to celebrate with God working in your life and pushing you to that next level of your education or that next part of your life. Maybe it's the workforce or whatever it may be. So we want to celebrate with you. So if you are a graduate or you have someone in your family that's graduating, that's part of the Sunrise family, reach out to us and let us know at office@sunrisecommunity.org or just call the office and let us know that they are graduating, and so we can make sure that they are celebrated as well. So, hey, boys and girls, it is now that time where we want to just gather around and hear God's word with you guys. And so Miss Cheryl will be sharing with you a little bit of what God's doing in our story.
Good morning, boys and girls, and moms and dads. Isn't it great that our God doesn't need us to be in the Sunrise building for us to learn about Him and to meet with Him? He meets us right in the middle of our lives, wherever we're at. We're going to fast forward our story today, many years from what Paige taught us last week, and meet a man named Moses. A new Pharaoh has become king, and he hates God's people. As we listen to today's story, I want you to pay special attention to what was Moses doing when God met with him, and what was the special name that God used to introduce himself. Let's watch together.
Years after Joseph brought his family to Egypt, Joseph died. His family stayed in Egypt. They were known as Israelites because they came from the family of Jacob, who was called Israel. A new Pharaoh came to power, and he was afraid of the Israelites. The family had grown so big. Pharaoh worried they would join Egypt's enemies and fight against him. Pharaoh made the Israelites slaves and gave them very hard work to do. But their families kept growing. Pharaoh ordered for all their baby boys to be killed. Around this time, a woman gave birth to a son. She hid him as long as she could, and then she put him in a basket and set it along the banks of the Nile River. The baby's older sister, Miriam, stayed nearby and watched the basket. Soon, Pharaoh's daughter went to the river to take a bath. She found the basket and saw the crying baby. Pharaoh's daughter felt sorry for the baby and wanted him to be her son. The princess named the baby Moses. When Moses grew up, he saw an Egyptian man mistreating an Israelite man. Moses killed the Egyptian. Pharaoh found out what Moses did and he was angry. So Moses fled Egypt. He worked as a shepherd in Midian for many years. Moses got married and had a family. Still, the Israelite people in Egypt were miserable and they cried out to God. God heard them and he planned to help them. One day, Moses saw a burning bush. The bush was not burning up. Suddenly, God called from the bush, "Moses, Moses." Moses replied, "Here I am." God told Moses to take off his sandals because Moses was standing on holy ground. Then God said, "I have seen how my people are suffering. I want you to lead them out of Egypt to a good land I have for them." Moses wondered if the Israelites even remembered God. "What if they ask for your name? What should I tell them?" "I am who I am," God said. "Tell them, I am has sent me to you." "What if they don't believe me?" Moses asked. So God gave Moses three miraculous signs to prove that God had appeared to him. Moses' staff would turn into a snake. His hand would become diseased and then healed. And the water from the river would turn into blood. Moses still made excuses and said, "Please send someone else." Now God was angry, but he agreed to send Moses' brother Aaron with him. So Moses went to Egypt. God saved Moses' life and called him to rescue God's people from slavery. The calling of Moses points to a greater calling and rescue, the call of Jesus to come to earth to save God's people. Jesus gave up his life to save us from slavery to sin.
Many times we have seen God use terribly hard situations to bring glory to himself and to bless his people. Moses was born into a very hard situation. He was born in a country and a culture that hated him from the moment he was born. But Moses' story teaches us about God's sovereignty. Sovereignty is a really big word. But what it means is that there's nothing that could happen to us, no situation that's more powerful than our God. When Moses grew up and left Egypt, he probably thought, never going back there. But God had a different plan. God called Moses to be the one to lead his people out of captivity in Egypt. When Moses met God, what was he doing? That's right, he was taking care of sheep. In the middle of normal life, God said, "I have observed the misery of my people. I know about their sufferings, and I am sending you, Moses, so that you can lead my people out of Egypt." Moses tried to get out of it at first, claiming he couldn't speak well enough. But God showed Moses his power. And guys, this is really important. God reminded Moses that his plans do not rely on the power of people. God's plans rely on the power of God alone. Now, did you guys catch the name that God used to introduce himself to Moses? That's right. He called himself, "I am who I am." The very most basic and important thing for us to know about God is that he's real. He exists. He always has existed. He always will exist. God never changes. That kind of reminds me of our big picture question. Is there anything God cannot do? No, God can do all things according to His character. That means because God is all powerful and He's perfectly good, we can trust Him always to do what is best. Nothing stops God's perfect plan. Will you say the memory verse with me before we go? Hosea 13:4 says, "I have been the Lord your God ever since you came out of Egypt. You shall acknowledge no God but me, no Savior except me." Hosea's words here would have reminded the Israelite people that God was with them even in that super sad time of being slaves. But it also reminds you and me that Jesus is God the Son and the only one who saves us from being slaves to sin. Thanks for joining us this morning, boys and girls. Can't wait to see you in person.
Vamos a cantar con la música del cielo. Vamos a cantar alegres porque escuchas cuando cantamos para exaltar tu nombre.
Una vez más,
vamos a cantar con la música. Cielo, vamos a cantar alegres porque escuchas cuando cantamos para exaltar tu nombre.
What's not to love?
What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one, you are the one we're living for.
We will sing.
We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift frees us. You are the light that leads us, like a fire burning. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for.
Yes, and we will sing.
We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Let's sing it again. We will sing.
We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise.
Surround me with a song. Good morning, brothers and sisters of Sunrise. Again, this is Elder Tony coming to you for the Elder Prayer this morning. And this morning's focus is about peace and quiet. It's something that is hard to find right now. The airways, social media are on fire. Approximately 3 months ago, it's as if our country was hit with a phenomena called COVID. The fallout from COVID is obvious, but in the middle of that, problem. We have now been hit with the George Floyd conversation, and it has opened up the floodgates of social media. So I wanted to come to you this morning with a word of encouragement that would minister to your hearts and to your minds, and let us be one in Christ. So our context this morning is differences, and the differences in society spurs all kinds of conversations. But this is not a new conversation. As I look inside scripture, we look at the church at Philippi. The church at Philippi was actually a suburb to the east side of Rome, and they were surrounded by other suburbs where Paul went on his missionary journey to establish churches. What was unique about the church at Philippi is it was as diverse as we are. And when I say we, I mean Sunrise. We know that Philippians talks about a woman named Lydia. Lydia seemed to be a seamstress, maybe even an artist, because she sold wares that were at the higher ticket end in the workplace. So Lydia probably was a person of means. It also refers to a Jewish jailer who probably lived in the middle, made enough income where he could establish a home and, you know, raise his children. And then it goes on to talk about a young girl who was demon-possessed, who was delivered by Christ. So what do all these people have in common is that they all got saved. And they all contributed to the works of the church at Philippi. So now we find Paul, right, jailed, writing a letter back to the members of the Philippian church, thanking them for their generosity. And who's he thanking? He's thanking diversity. He's thanking people of different social classes, different religions, maybe even different hues of skin. But how is that possible? How is it possible? And it was made possible because they were reconciled into Christ. Being reconciled into Christ is our foundation. That foundation allows us to have a vertical relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. It allows us to be foundational in how we relate to ourselves and how we relate to others and how we serve our community, although we may be diverse. So as the noise is not going to settle anytime soon, and I actually have a little fear that we could get hit with another lightning bolt that would drive another wedge through our country. But for the citizens of Christ, no matter what lightning bolts hit our communities, hit our lives, we have the promise that As in Galatians chapter 3, I believe verse 28 says, now there is no longer any Jew nor Gentile, right? No free, no slave, no male, no female, but one in Christ. And we are the seed of Abraham, and that makes us what? Eligible to receive the promises that was given to him. So I want to meet you in Philippians chapter 4. I'm going to start in verse 8. This scripture ministered to me when I had my lightning bolt in my young life. It was called the Rodney King Riots. And I happened to go to Calvary Chapel to play basketball one night, but we go to church first and then we would play in the gym at midnight or so. And the minister that spoke that night pulled this scripture, and it ministered to me then, and I hope it ministers to you now. So Philippians 4:8 starts out, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are good, of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is any anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. Let's pray. Father, I lift up the entire church body of Sunrise to you, Lord, and I pray that we remain knitted together as one, Lord, just as you and the Father are one. Lord, everything that was created, Lord, is created by you. It's yours, and you hold it together, just like you will hold us together, no matter the disruptions, the lightning strikes, the pandemics, Lord, or whatever is to come. Lord, our peace is anchored in you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The sun sets free. Good morning, Sunrise. My name is Maria Rodriguez.
Y yo soy Hector Rodriguez.
Today I'm going to be reading from Judges chapter 2, verse 11 through 16.
Hoy vamos a leer Jueces capítulo 2, verso 11 al 16.
Then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals. They forsook the Lord, the God of their ancestors, who had brought them out of Egypt. They followed and worshiped various gods of the people around them. They aroused the Lord's anger because they forsook him and served Baal and the Ashtoreth. In his anger against Israel, the Lord gave them into the hands of the raiders, who plundered them. He sold them into the hands of their enemies all around, who they were no longer able to resist. Whenever Israel went out to fight, the hand of the Lord was against them to defeat them, just as he had sworn to them. They were in great distress. Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of these raiders.
Esos israelitas hicieron lo que ofende al Señor y adoraron a los ídolos de Baal. Abandonaron al Señor, Dios de sus padres, que los había sacado de Egipto, y siguieron a otros dioses, dioses de los pueblos que los rodeaban, y los abandonaron, provocando así la ira del Señor. Abandonaron al Señor y adoraron a Baal y a las imágenes de Astarte. Entonces el Señor se enfureció contra los israelitas y los entregó en manos de los invasores, que los saquearon, los vendió a sus enemigos, que también a sus alrededor, a los que ya no pudieron hacer frente. Cada vez que los israelitas salieron a combatir, la mano del Señor estaba en contra de ellos para su mal, tal como el Señor se lo había dicho y jurado. Así llegaron a verse muy angustiados. Entonces el Señor hizo seguir caudillos que los libraron del poder de esos invasores.
Miss you, Sunrise. God bless.
Que Dios los bendiga.
Thank you so much, Hector, Maria, for sharing the scripture. Gracias, Hector y Maria, por compartir la palabra. And thank you to all of you who have been so willing to read. If you want to do that, let us know, and we'll be coming to ask you as well. Si quieren a leer la palabra de Dios, déjenos saber y estamos muy dispuestos a que puedan participar. So, like you, we have a washing machine at home, and that washing machine has this thing called the spin cycle. I'm sure you're familiar with it. La lavadora tiene un ciclo de giro. It's that time during the cleaning process where the machine, you know, begins to spin. It begins to rotate quite rapidly. La máquina empieza a rodar rápidamente. And the whole idea is that it's pushing the water out. It's rinsing the water out. Está quitando el agua. Very important. Now, the thing about this spin cycle is once it gets going, it is really hard to stop. Es difícil parar este ciclo de giro. In fact, if you hit just the pause button on the machine, at least our machine at home, if you hit the pause button, it's going to take a minute or two for the spinning to stop. Si en todo caso el botón de pausa va a llevar un minuto para que pare. And in that time, you can't lift up the lid. It's locked. La tapa está con llave. No puedes levantar la tapa. In fact, if you try to do it even faster by just turning the machine off, si apagas la máquina, same thing's going to happen, at least with our machine. It'll just keep spinning, slowing down, and you can't lift up the lid until it completely stops. No puedes levantar la tapa hasta que pare 100%. Why? Why is that? Well, it's a safety feature. Es algo de seguridad. If some child were to come in and to lift up the lid while the machine is spinning and stick in their hand or stick in their arm, they could be injured quite severely. Si un niño levanta la tapa y mete el brazo, se puede lastimar. You've got to be careful with the spin cycle. The spin cycle has momentum to it, and that momentum can be very dangerous. El ciclo de giro tiene un momentum que es muy peligroso. Well, I talk about that this morning because today I would like to look at Judges chapter 2, and here we find in the Bible another kind of spin cycle. Vemos un ciclo de giro en Jueces 2. It's a what you might call a downward spin cycle. Es un ciclo descendente. In fact, this is important because the consensus of those who study this book is that this spin cycle that's seen in the book of Judges is really key. It's key to understanding the message of the entire book. El ciclo de giro descendente de Jueces es clave para entender el mensaje de este libro. And today we're beginning a new series of messages, and we're calling it Here Come the Judges. Hoy comenzamos una serie, Aquí Vienen los Jueces. And in this series, through the summertime, what I'm hoping that we can do is that we can explore for a few weeks this little explored part of God's Word. Queremos explorar esta parte de la palabra que no es muy explorada. And by looking at this, I hope that we can read its ancient message and really see out of this ancient message a very relevant and timely message for our lives today. En este mensaje antiguo hay algo relevante para nosotros hoy. And so we dive in order to understand the context or the whole setting of the book of Judges, I think we can go to the verse before the one I've just read in Judges chapter 2, verse 10. En 2:10 vemos lo que es el contexto de Jueces. And this is what it says. It says, after that whole generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. También murió toda aquella generación y surgió otra que no conocía al Señor ni sabía lo que él había hecho por Israel. So, what's this about? The book of Judges begins with Joshua, the leader of Israel, and Caleb, another leader, coming into the promised land with the people of Israel, and they begin to conquer the promised land. Josué y Caleb y otros empiezan a conquistar la tierra prometida. They cross over the river Jordan, and they follow God's command. And God's command was to kick out all of the Canaanites, the godless people that were living in that land. Dios les mandó de expulsar a los cananeos impíos que estaban en esa tierra. And for the most part, they do that. The first chapter or two of Judges talks about some of the victories they have. There are a number of victories, a number of times when they are successful. Tienen éxito, tienen victorias. However, that success is incomplete. They do not completely do what God asks of them. They do not get some of the peoples out of there. No expulsan a todos los cananeos. There are some Canaanites that are left in the land. And that's a problem. Because you see, those Canaanites begin to influence the people of Israel. They begin to attract them and seduce them to worship some of their gods, the Baals and the Ashtoreths and the Asherahs, they're called. Los cananeos les seducen a adorar algunos de sus dioses. In fact, 2:10 tells us that after Joshua and Caleb and that entire great first generation dies out, there's another generation that comes up and they do not know God. And they don't remember what God has done for Israel by bringing them into the promised land. Cuando murió esa generación de Josué y Caleb, otra generación viene que no sabe nada del Señor, no conocen al Señor ni recuerdan lo que él ha hecho. And here is where the downward spin cycle begins. We need to note that. Aquí comienza el ciclo de giro descendente. Let's look at Judges 2, verse 11. Jueces 2, 11. It says, then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And it says, they served the Baals. Esos israelitas hicieron lo que ofende al Señor y adoraron a los ídolos de Baal. And it says, they forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who brought them out of Egypt.
They followed and worshipped various gods of the peoples around them. Abandonaron al Señor Dios de sus padres que los había sacado de Egipto y siguieron otros dioses de los pueblos que los rodeaban. And then it says that they also provoked the Lord to anger. Provocaron así la ira del Señor. Why? Because they worshipped the Baals and the Ashtoreths. Adoraron a los Baales y también a las imágenes de Astarte. These are the local fertility gods. These are the gods that are supposed to guarantee success with flocks and success with fields. Son los dioses de la prosperidad, del éxito con los rebaños y con las cosechas. And so the first stop on the downward spin cycle is that Israel falls into sin. Israel falls into idolatry because they forsake the Lord. Israel cae en pecado en idolatría porque ellos abandonan al Señor. And because they get into this sin of idol worship, soon they experience the consequences of that sin. Después experimentan las consecuencias de esa rebelión. Look at verse 14. Versículo 14, it says, in his anger against Israel, the Lord handed them over to raiders who plundered them. Entonces el Señor se enfureció contra los israelitas y los entregó en manos de invasores que los saquearon. He sold them, it says, to their enemies all around. So because Israel falls into sin, God sends them back to slavery, where they were in Egypt before. Les envía Dios a la esclavitud. The second part of the downward spin cycle then is slavery. It says that they were invaded by raiders. Fueron invadidos por invasores. Not the Oakland Raiders, mind you. These guys were worse than that. These were the nations all around them that were completely strong. In fact, verse 15 says that God was on the side of the raiders. God was actually rooting for the raiders because he had told Israel, if you forsake me, I'll go on the other side and I'll attack you. Dice que Dios estaba en contra de Israel y a favor de sus invasores. In fact, verse 15 says, it gets to a point where they were in great distress. Israel's in distress. Llegaron a verse muy angustiados, dice en el 15. And that's where we come then to the next part of the downward cycle. It's verse 16, versículo 16. Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of these raiders. Entonces el Señor hizo surgir jueces o caudillos que los libraron del poder de esos invasores. So Israel gets to its lowest point and God steps in. God intervenes and here come the judges. Dios interviene y aquí vienen los jueces. Now, when we say judges, we need to understand that the book of Judges isn't talking about what we might have in mind. You know, when we think of judges, we think of guys in black robes with white wigs and a gavel sitting in a courtroom. That's not what this is talking about. Jueces no se refiere a hombres de túnica negra, con un mazo, con peluca blanca. That's not at all. We're not talking about courtroom judges. What we're talking about here, the word judges here refers to local leaders. These are tribal chieftains, son líderes locales, jefes tribales. These are regional governors, if you might want to say that. And they are mighty men that God then raises up in order to give relief to Israel from their enemies. Son hombres que Dios levanta para tener victoria sobre sus enemigos. In fact, verse 18 tells us what these judges are all about. Versículo 18. Whenever the Lord raised up a judge for them, he was with the judge and saved them out of the hands of their enemies as long as the judge lived. For the Lord had compassion on them as they groaned under those who oppressed and afflicted them. Cada vez que el Señor levantaba entre ellos un juez, estaba con él. Mientras ese caudillo juez vivía, los libraba del poder de sus enemigos porque el Señor se compadía de ellos al oírlos gemir por causa de los que los oprimían. So get this picture. Israel gets to the bottom, they're in distress, and they begin to groan. Literally, they begin to cry out to God. Gimen en su angustia al Señor. Claman. And God, it says, is compassionate. He relents. He listens to them. Dios se compadece ellos. And how does he do that? by raising up a judge. He raises up a judge to save them, to deliver them. And so here comes the judge. He does his work, saves Israel, and they all go off riding into the sunset and live happily ever after. The end, right? Y así todo está bien, ¿verdad? Not exactly. No es así. Look at verse 19 with me. Judges 2, 19, versículo 19. But when the judge died, the people returned to ways even more corrupt than those of their fathers, following other gods and serving and worshiping them. They refused to give up their evil practices. Pero cuando el juez moría, ellos volvían a corromperse aún más que sus antepasados, pues se iban tras otros dioses a los que servían y adoraban. So God delivers them, raises up the judge, and gives them victory. And as soon as things get good, Israel goes back to the same thing, to sin and idolatry, only worse, and the downward spin cycle begins all over again. Israel, una vez que esté bien, tranquilo, vuelve al mismo ciclo de pecado y idolatría. And this is the pattern. This is the repeating pattern that we're going to see throughout the book of Judges. Sin, which leads to slavery, which leads to distress, which leads to crying out to God, which leads to God raising up a judge, which leads to God saving the people, which leads to peace, which leads to complacency, which leads to sin all over again. Pecado, esclavitud, lleva angustia, a clamar a Dios, un juez, y luego salvación, después complacencia, y lo mismo. And so this is the pattern. And in fact, we see this very pattern in the story, the classic story of the very first judge. And I want to look at that with you. Vamos a ver esto en el patrón en la primera historia del primer juez. It's in Judges chapter 3, verse 7. Let's see if we can track the cycle here. Vamos a ver si podemos ver el ciclo. It says in verse 7, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God and served the Baals and the Asherahs. Los israelitas hicieron lo que ofende al Señor. Se olvidaron del Señor su Dios y adoraron a las imágenes de Baal y de Asherah. So there's the first part, right? They fall into sin. They fall into idolatry. Caen en pecado y idolatría. Verse 8, the anger of the Lord burned against Israel so that he sold them, that's a slavery term, into the hands of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram-Naharaim, to whom the Israelites were subject for 8 years. El Señor se enfureció contra Israel a tal grado que los vendió a Cushan-Rishathaim, rey de Aram-Naharaim, a quien estuvieron esclavizados, sometidos durante 8 años. What's that? Obviously, that's slavery. They're sold to this guy, say his name 5 times fast, Cushan-Rishathaim, that's his name, and they're slaves. Son esclavos de Cushan-Rishathaim. And then verse 9, but when they cried out to the Lord, he raised up for them a deliverer, Othniel, son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, who saved them. Pero clamaron al Señor y él hizo que surgiera un libertador, Otoniel, hijo de Kenaz, hermano menor de Caleb. Y Otoniel liberó a los israelitas. So again, they get to the bottom, cry out to God, help God, and he sends a judge. Here comes the judge. Claman a Dios y aquí viene un juez. It's Othniel. And Othniel is really interesting because his older brother is Caleb, who was a leader from that first great generation. Su hermano mayor es Caleb de la primera gran generación. And Othniel saves them. Let's look at verse 10 then. It says, the Spirit of the Lord came upon him so that he became Israel's judge and went to war. And the Lord gave Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram, into the hands of Othniel, who overpowered him. El Espíritu del Señor vino sobre Otoniel, y así Otoniel se convirtió en juez o caudillo, y salió la guerra. El Señor entregó a Cushan-Rishathaim, rey de Aram, en manos de Otoniel. So here's something interesting that we're going to want to keep our eyes on, and that is that it says the Spirit of God came on the judge. The Holy Spirit came upon the judge. The Spirit of God comes upon the judges so that it's evident that what they're doing in delivering Israel is not just through human power. It's God's power working through them. El Espíritu Santo viene sobre el juez para que el poder de Dios se manifieste en su victoria. And what's the result of that? ¿Cuál es el resultado? Verse 11. So the land had peace for 40 years until Othniel, son of Kenaz, died. El país tuvo paz durante 40 años hasta que murió Otoniel, hijo de Kenaz. So the Holy Spirit is on Othniel, and the Holy Spirit is on the people of Israel, but get this, it's only for a season. It's only for a time. El Espíritu Santo está sobre ellos solo un tiempo. The land has peace for 40 years, 40 años de paz. Order, stability, tranquility, but it's not forever. No es un paz duradera. It doesn't last. And as we're going to see next week, actually, when we get into our second judge, as soon as Othniel, the first judge, dies, guess what? Israel's right back into the same old downward spin cycle. Otra vez, Israel cae en el mismo ciclo descendente. Sin, and then slavery, and then crying out to God, and then a judge comes along, and then there's victory and peace, and then there's complacency, only to start it all over again. Pecado, esclavitud, clamando a Dios, victoria, paz, y después complacencia. Now here's the question I want to ask you. Does that cycle remind you of anything? Is that story that we're looking at here familiar to you in any way? ¿Es familiar esa historia? I have to say that after nearly 30 years now in pastoral ministry, this is a story that I've not only read in the book of Judges, but it's a story that I've seen. I've seen this story repeated in the lives of people over the years. He visto este patrón en la vida de las personas durante mi tiempo de ministerio pastoral. And sadly enough, this has become for some the pattern of their walk with God. Para algunos es su patrón de caminar con Dios. Perhaps you've seen it too. Perhaps you've been a part of it. Maybe you've experienced it for yourself, or have you seen it in others? Someone comes to faith in Jesus. Praise God. Alguien llega a fe en Jesús. And for a while, things are going pretty good. Life is stable. There's peace. But then, this person gets distracted. They get attracted to the fertility gods of the world, the prosperity gods, the pleasure gods. Se atraen a los dioses de fertilidad y de placer. They fall into sin. They fall into immorality. Caen a la inmoralidad. And inevitably, that leads them into slavery. Están esclavizados, addiction, broken relationships, debt, problems at work, problems with the law, adicción, relaciones rotas, deudas, problemas con el trabajo, la ley. And what does that do? That leads them to fall down to the bottom, and then they cry out to God, God, help me, God, get me out of this fix. Claman a Dios, and God shows up. God shows up. Dios llega y comparece. And when God shows up, then they show up. They show up to church. They show up to Bible study. They show up to Wednesday night. They show up with God's people, and they're loud, and they're proud, and they're fervent, and they're on fire for God. Están fervientes en su testimonio para Dios. They're on fire until they're not. And then once things kind of calm down and get easy again, they fall into complacency and they disappear. Después se desaparecen, and the whole downward spin cycle begins all over again. It's something I've seen. Perhaps it's something you've experienced. A lo mejor has experimentado esto. And it might even cause you to ask the question, is this the way it's supposed to be? Is this the way that God intended for us to live? Is this really the best that we can hope for, to go on this endless roller coaster with God? ¿Es lo mejor que podemos esperar? ¿Es lo que Dios quiso por nosotros? And I want to say with every fiber of my being, absolutely not. No tiene que ser así. In fact, I think that the book of Judges is actually written to show us that that doesn't have to be the case. The book of Judges is showing us the results of what happens when we try to manage and to control our relationship with God. When we are in charge, cuando intentamos controlar la relación con Dios, es lo que los jueces nos muestran. The book of Judges really shows us that we need something more than God to come in and help us with our agenda. We need something more than to see God as like a fire alarm, break in case of fire, or like the ripcord on your parachute, pull that in case of emergency. Dios no es un Dios solo de las urgencias. God's not simply a God of our emergencies. We need more than help from God with our little agenda. We need God. We need God Himself, and we need God's agenda. Ocupamos a Dios y la agenda de Dios. So the solution is really, I think, found for us in the New Testament. And I want to read a scripture and unpack it for you because I think it really points to where we can go in this downward spin cycle. It's from Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 through 9, Hebreos 5, 7 al 9. This is what it says. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, He offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save Him from death. And He was heard because of His reverent submission. Although He was a son, He learned obedience from what He suffered, and once made perfect, He became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey Him. En los días de su vida mortal, Jesús ofreció oraciones y súplicas con fuerte clamor y lágrimas al que podía salvarlo de la muerte, y fue escuchado por su reverente sumisión. Aunque era hijo, mediante el sufrimiento aprendió a obedecer, y consumada su perfección, llegó a ser autor de salvación eterna para todos los que le obedecen. Now, like I said, I want to unpack this. What is this saying? ¿Qué dice? It's saying that when Jesus, the Son of God, came down to earth, cuando llegó Jesús a la tierra, He came into our world, He came into our sinful condition, llegó a nuestra condición pecaminosa, but He did not enter our downward spin cycle. He didn't get caught up in that. No se atrapó en el ciclo descendente del pecado. Where people on earth here were sinning and forsaking God and going away from God, donde la gente abandonaba a Dios, Jesus always remembered His Father's will. He always obeyed His Father. He always honored His Father. He always did what was right. Jesús siempre obedecía a su Padre, hacía lo bueno. Where people were stuck in slavery to their sin, Jesus wasn't stuck. He actually was setting people free. He was setting people out of slavery. Jesús estaba expulsando a los que estaban en esclavitud, es decir, a librándolos. He was casting out demons and healing sick people, and He was confronting false teachers with their false teachings and those things that were holding people down. Expulsaba demonios, sanaba enfermos y se oponía a los que tenían falsas enseñanzas que oprimían. Where people were crying out to God in their distress and saying, "Save us, God, help us." Jesus, it says here, also cried out with prayers and tears and loud cries to God. La gente clamaba a Dios buscando salvación. Jesús también clamaba con oraciones y lágrimas. But Jesus wasn't crying out to be saved from death. He was crying out that He might go to death. For us, estaba clamando para ir a la muerte, no para ser salvo de la muerte. He cried out to the one, it says, who could save Him from death. But He didn't cry out to be saved from death. He cried out and said, "Your will be done, Father." That's what He cried out. And it says He was heard because of His reverent submission. Clamaba, "Hágase tu voluntad, Padre." Fue escuchado por su reverente sumisión. And once this work of obedience was complete, once it was perfected, He rose again from the dead. And it says now, He is the eternal source of salvation for those who obey and follow him. Una vez consumada su obra en su muerte en la cruz, resucitó y ahora es autor de salvación eterna para los que le obedecen. What does that mean? It means that Jesus is now the one who saves us from the downward spin cycle, but not just temporarily. So we fall into it again. He saves us from it eternally. Él nos salva del ciclo descendente eternamente. So you see, escaping the downward spin cycle of sin and slavery is possible not by trying harder to be better. That's just not going to work. No escapamos al ciclo descendente intentando ser mejores. Escape is possible by getting connected to Jesus, the one who breaks the cycle, by his death, by his resurrection, by his perfect obedience to our Father. El escape es por Jesús quien murió y resucitó para quebrar el ciclo descendente. So here's the deal. The story of faithless Israel in the book of Judges, it really, in an odd way, points us to the story of Jesus, the faithful judge. Jesus is the faithful judge on whom the Spirit of God has come forever, not just for a season. And he is the one who will save us. Jesús es el juez fiel sobre el cual el Espíritu Santo está con él y él nos salva para siempre. That's the good news. And that's what I hope we'll see as we go through this series. Son las buenas noticias. So I want to ask you this morning, where are you? ¿Dónde estás? Are you in a downward cycle? ¿Estás en el ciclo descendente? Are you finding that your life is kind of a circle? You're going from guilt to seeking God for a while, and then finding relief, and then getting complacent, and then falling back into guilt again. Estás en culpabilidad, buscando a Dios, encontrando alivio, andando en complacencia para volver a la culpabilidad. If that is the pattern of your life and the pattern of your walk with God, I have good news for you, for all of us. We can cry out to God. Podemos clamar a Dios, and God will have compassion on us. Cry out to God, clamen a Dios, but not like Israel did. Israel just cried out to God to get out of a fix. They just wanted relief. Israel solo buscaba alivio. Cry out to God for something deeper. Cry out to God for lasting, total transformation. Cry out to God for God himself. And here's the thing, he supplied the answer to our prayer in Jesus. Clama a Dios buscando transformación total y buscando a Dios mismo en la persona de Jesús. You see, we don't have to live in the cycle. We can live in a different way. In fact, the Christian life is not a circle. Christian life is a line. It's a road that goes forward. La vida cristiana es un camino que va hacia adelante. In fact, it's a road that comes, that takes us out of slavery, out of Egypt. It's an exodus, and it's a road that's going into the promised land. Es un camino hacia la tierra prometida. And the road to the promised land is not just a set of steps, it's a person. The road is Jesus. El camino es Jesús. Jesus is our escape from the downward cycle. Jesús es nuestro escape del ciclo descendente. And so I want to invite you right now to pray with me. Let's call out to him for our help. Vamos a buscar y clamar a él. Let's pray. Oremos. Lord Jesus, I pray that this word here from the book of Judges will help us all to evaluate the kind of trajectory our lives are taking. Que podamos evaluar la trayectoria de nuestra vida a raíz de esta palabra, Señor. I want to pray for those that feel like they're stuck in a merry-go-round of failure and frustration, God. I believe with all my heart that's not your intention for anyone. You want to give life and give it abundantly. Señor, yo pido por los que están en ese ciclo vicioso de frustración y de problemas. Lord Jesus, we do cry out for you to touch us. We cry out to you for our land. We cry out to you for our neighborhoods. We cry out to you for those who are suffering. We cry out to you for a total transformation of our hearts and lives, but a transformation of everything around us, because what we're crying out for is for your kingdom to come and your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Clamamos para que tú puedas traer una transformación a nuestro corazón y a todo el mundo, que venga tu reino y se haga tu voluntad. And so, Lord, this week, I pray that we can walk on that road to victory, understanding that you are the road, Jesus. Teach us. Teach us to live in a different way, not to act out the same old drama of spiritual failure. Que no actuemos según un drama de fracaso espiritual. Help us to live that abundant life. Jesus, you are the way to that life. You are the truth. You are that life. Jesús, tú eres ese camino, esa verdad y esa vida que buscamos. We thank you for who you are. All honor and glory be to you. In Jesus' name, en el nombre del Señor Jesús, lo pedimos. Amén. so glad you could be with us for our online worship today. Gracias por estar en línea con nosotros. We're going to continue in this pattern for the time being, but we believe that every single Sunday, every single week brings us that much closer to that step where we can be not only outdoors and online, but we can be indoors and together. Esperamos estar no solo al aire libre y en línea, sino juntos otra vez en nuestro edificio. So just keep praying for that and stay in tune and in touch. We'll try to keep you updated as time goes. Que estén en comunicación y en oración por nosotros. I want to leave you with a blessing that comes from the very end of the book of Ephesians. Quiero darles una bendición de Efesios. This is what it says. Peace to the brothers and sisters and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus with an undying love. Que Dios el Padre y el Señor Jesucristo les concedan paz, amor y fe a los hermanos y a las hermanas. La gracia sean con todos los que aman a nuestro Señor Jesucristo con amor imperecedero. God bless you and have a good week walking with Jesus. Que tengan buena semana caminando con Jesús.
Morning, Sunrise. Greg here. I want to let you know about a great new tool coming to Sunrise that make giving just that much easier, and that is our text to give tool. All you have to do is text at SunriseCC to 52014. You will get a text back asking you for the dollar amount of your donation. Put in the dollar amount and press send. It'll send you back a prompt for the first time to go to a website. This is to fill out all your information. You simply put in all your information. About halfway through the website, it'll ask you if this is a one-time gift or something that you would like to see reoccurring. After you've filled in your card information, there's a big blue button at the very bottom that says donate. Now, this is only necessary for the first time that you use this tool. After that, you will be able to simply text at SunriseCC to 52014. And then it'll ask you again what the dollar amount that you would like to donate is. You fill in that amount and push send, and right away your donation is on its way, faster than any of those blue bags pass down the aisles. Now remember, this is just a tool for us to be more intentional in our giving back to God. We hope this tool makes things easier and more full of joy as we continue to grow in our understanding of what it means to be generous people with a generous God. Blessings.
Darkness. You're the only right among the wrong. You're the only hope among the chaos. You are the voice that calls me on, louder than every lie, my sword in every fight. The truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle. Mighty, it won't let us down or fail us. Your name is power. Your name is power. I know that the word will never fail. Oh, oh, oh. I know that in every situation, yes, I know you speak the power to prevail. Louder than every lie, my sword in every fight, the truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful
night or darkness, light arrives and heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. When you speak, the church awakens. We believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. When you speak, you scatter darkness, light arrives and heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us see it. When you speak, the church awakens. We believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, struggle, mighty, it won't let us down, our failures. Your name is power over darkness. Your name is power in the chaos. Your name is power. A story of grace. We have an anthem of hope. We have a reason to pray.